Thank you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
Because the thing is that God wants and needs access to our hearts. Any part, any way, any day, anyhow, at any point. Can God access your heart? What we've really got to ask ourselves is this important question. Have I downgraded God's status? So I want to give you access to point out to me what you know, because I'm not sure that I know what you know. I really believe that most of us, if not all of us, are being held back by just one thing. So there's one step we need to take. There's one move we need to make. There's one thought we need to think. There's one word we need to say. There's one thing we need to change. You are just one small step away from one massive breakthrough. Let me tell you the moral of the story that we read that Jesus shared about this guy. Because really it wasn't just about rich people. It wasn't about really someone having money. That's not the issue. Someone having money is not an issue. I hope that people come into our church and they got money. Did I just say that out loud? I did. I'll get put on Facebook for that, I expect. But listen, let me explain myself, because, you know, you need to quantify what you say and qualify what you say. Listen, money is not evil. Somehow, in the process of scriptures being quoted over the years, we grew up with money is the root of all evil. No, the love of money is the root of all evil. Listen, if Jesus wasn't into money, why did he have a business manager? You read new versions of the Bible and you will find out that he had a woman as a business manager on the road with him, because Jesus was on tour. And he needed people to look after his financial affairs. So if Jesus needed money, we're going to need money. So we need money. We need more money to be able to do more of what we want to do and reach more people. So he wasn't saying that money was wrong. He wasn't having a go at a rich person. What he was doing was illustrating that here's a person for whom possessions had become their God. Here was a person that had something in the way of God and the life that God had given him. And he said, there's just one thing you need to do. You just need to let go of that and follow me. Think about that for a moment, because I was thinking about that. I was thinking about that story. And you know, it's amazing that this guy was being offered the opportunity to hang with Jesus while he was still on earth. When he said, follow me, it was like, come and be part of my team. Come and be with me. Remember, he'd already said that to a couple of other guys, and they're all starting to make excuses and give reasons for why they couldn't just drop everything and go. And that illustrates what we're like in life sometimes. We'll go, oh God, tomorrow I'll do that. And Jesus said something really pretty harsh. He said, listen, I know that, you know, you've got to go back and bury someone, but I'm calling you right now to follow me, so let them bury him, and you just come with me right now. And you're like, cool, that's a bit hard. Yeah, Jesus was hard sometimes, because, listen, we're talking about the Son of God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and when he gives you an opportunity, don't pass it up. You might not ever get it again. And then he was saying, and beyond this life, you can have eternal life. Now, listen to what I'm about to say. Nothing should get in the way of an offer like that. But it did, and it does. Because it did for him, and it does for us. I completely lost where I am, because I just so had that in my spirit. But we'll find our way back into my notes at some point. But you know, one of the reasons that God needs that access is because, you know, it's like this guy was trying to say to him, listen, you can go there, but don't go there. Why did he go away sad and not glad? Because he was really annoyed that Jesus had gone to that place in his heart that he didn't want him to go to. Isn't it amazing that Jesus knew? Jesus knew all about him. Jesus knows all about you. You can run, but you can't hide. He knows everything about me. And I'm like, really? Your voice gets higher. People start freaking out when I start sharing honestly like that. Then they start thinking, oh, what's this life that Pastor Mike's got that we don't know about? I'm not talking about some secret life I've got. I'm just saying, I'm not all that in a bag of chips. Sometimes I can be put on a pedestal because I'm standing on a platform, but I'm no better at this than you. Look, I might be anointed to preach this stuff, but I'm no more anointed to live it than you are. I have my days where I struggle to keep my mind in gear and say the right things and do the right things, and just like you do. Now, I hope me sharing that doesn't cause concern for you, but actually it just encourages you. Don't let the devil start taking your mind somewhere where I've never gone. Oh, where does Pastor Mike go during the week? Because I know how the devil works. He'll start putting your mind in places. Hey, don't you start accusing me of doing that. Well, I'm just saying. I feel like Mike Walker. I'm not saying, I'm just saying. You know, God wants to go deeper to show us things that are truly there, because to go places where no man is gone so that we can get to where we haven't got. Listen to this. I hope this will encourage you. I haven't got much more to share, but I did kind of make my notes less this week because I had a feeling that God might turn up and say a bit more than I had on my notes. 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 9 says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. But it was to us that God revealed these things by his Spirit, for his Spirit searches out everything and shows us God's deep secrets. No one can know a person's thoughts except that person's own spirit. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's own spirit. And we have received God's spirit, not the world's spirit, so that we can know the wonderful things God has freely given us. Wow, we're in on something that is truly amazing. Let me just unpack that a little bit. The reason he wants that all-access status is because he wants to show us things we've never seen and tell us things we've never heard so that we'll experience things we've never known. We haven't yet lived all the life that there is to live. In fact, I would suggest we've only lived a very small percentage, because it's not about the amount of time you're here, but what you put into the time you're here. We might only have a few years left. We don't know when we're going to go to be with him. But whatever time we've got left, let's put the most into it that we can, because we really don't know how long we've got, so we may as well put everything into it. God wants to show us those deep down things, and he wants to dig up those things in us that so often get in the way of us, to get us to see what we haven't yet got in order to get it, because he's got a life prepared for us that we can't even imagine. He wants to do it exceedingly. I still love the old version, because you can't say it any better than that. Exceedingly, everybody say exceedingly. You have to put that, exceedingly. That was a South African version. Exceedingly, abundantly above, the Bible tells us, anything that we could ask, think, imagine, or dream in our wildest dreams. And I'm a wild dreamer. I can dream things about what God could do, and they are wild. I mean, they are so wild, you go, what? But I can go, I'm driving past lots of buildings right now in Western, and I'm going, God. God, that would make a great church. Oh, God, that would make a great church. Oh, God, that would make a great church. All in one day, three buildings. And, you know, then the devil comes along and knocks on the door of my mind and says, yeah, but do you know how much that would cost? And then I remind him, yeah, but my daddy owns the world. So, next question. See, we're put off by what the devil says, but what does he know? Seriously, what does he know? No ear has heard, no eye has seen, no mind has imagined what God has in store for Destiny Church. What God has in store for your life. And what he's trying to do is get us to see what he sees. So that's why he wants to have access to our hearts, so that we will start to see what he sees, so that we will get to know what he knows. Everybody with me? And so we will get to know the truth. And sometimes he's got to touch on that truth. And the truth will set us free. It's true. The truth will set us free. But we've got to be prepared to face the truth in order for it to free us. I've often said that the truth will eventually set you free, but it will initially make you mad. See, we are very, very clever and selective about the truth that we actually want to hear. So people can go there, but don't you go there. And you start to hear conversations that other people have about you, and they're having them in love, but so it's not strayed into gossip. They're talking about you in a positive way because they want to try and get through to you, but they don't quite know how to get through to you. So they talk to someone else to see if they know how to get through to you. And what comes up in conversation most of the time is, but you can't go there. I hope that I've never got areas in my life where people are going, don't go there. You touch on that and he'll explode. Now, people have said that about me. And you know, whenever I hear that, I go to my wife and I say, is that true? Now, hopefully she loves me enough to be able to go, do you know, darling, I'd never say that to you even if, no. I hope she loves me enough to be able to go, absolutely. They are so totally right and you need to sort it out. And there has been times when she's done that. Not quite as abrupt as that, but in a very loving way. The truth is a good thing. You know what this guy was doing was really saying to Jesus, there are things in my life that are off limits. Don't you go there, because if you touch that, well, you know. And this was off limits. Think of the story and how sad the story ends. That here was an opportunity for this guy that he might not ever get given again. Do we ever read about this guy again? How sad that someone had a one-off opportunity to do something with their life, and all they had to do was make one simple change that would change their life and transform their life forever. And I want to say to you today, if you will get what you haven't got, it will change your life forever. Rather than saying, God, don't go there, why don't we adopt this and say, God, if you don't go there, I won't grow there. I won't change. I'll be forever stuck in a rut, never moving on, never changing, forever limited. Forever within the boundaries of the things and issues in my heart that are containing me. Some of us are living contained lives and we need to break out. But in order to break out, God's got to be able to break through with the truth. We've got to give him access to all areas to talk about some of the things that we prefer not to talk about. And if we don't do it, what will happen? I reckon this is what God does. Sean mentioned it earlier. God comes along as a gentleman and he says, I would like access, please. Because God is so polite. I would really like access to your heart, please. And then if we ignore that, what we find is that we come across a time in life when suddenly out of nowhere, God didn't have to do anything, but we revealed to ourselves or someone else revealed to us the thing that God wanted to come along and talk about so that it wouldn't be public. Hello. He wants to do some stuff in private with us, because there are things in your heart. He doesn't want to expose them to the world. He doesn't want the world to know the other side of you. He wants to talk to you about that side so that he can deal with that. You can get right with God, and then you can move on and have a great life, and no one will ever know. It was just between you and him. Come on, if we were all honest right now, there have been thoughts that we've even had this last week. There are things that we've said. There are things that we've done. And we're like, God, I'm so glad that's just between you and me. And if we can't think of anything, it doesn't mean to say that we've become so holy that we're not making any mistakes anymore. We actually need more prayer than the person sat next to us that's owning up right now, because we're failing to see the things now that if it wasn't for God's grace, we wouldn't be living and breathing. I am only too aware of my weaknesses. That's why I don't need people reminding me what my weaknesses are. Remind me what my strengths are. But God, remind me what my weaknesses are so that I can turn them from weaknesses into strengths. I want to end by saying this. I'm going to have to get into some of the other thoughts next week. One of the versions says, investigate my life. Find out everything about me. Cross-examine me. Now you're talking my wife's language, because she's into all these law and orders and orders and laws and cutting up bodies. And every night I hear, oh, I've watched this one. I'm not surprised. You're addicted to them. I should be worried that the church is going to find a body under the bed one day. She knows too much about it. If I go disappearing, look under the bed. Cross-examine and test me. Get a clear picture of what I'm about. See for yourself whether I've done anything wrong. Then guide me on the road to eternal life. You get a good insurance payout as well. No, that isn't a good way to build the church. I want to be here. Cross-examine me. Wow. Do you know what God said about that? And I'll share more about it next week. To ask the question, are there things hidden that contradict things that are exposed? Cross-examine. Wow, am I contradicting certain things in my life? Are there contradictions in my life so that the things that I am doing right are affected by the things that are wrong? See, that's why I'm saying it's only going to take one change and everything could change for the rest of our lives. It only takes one single change. One thing, Jesus said, you lack. I wonder what that one thing is for you, because it's very personal. Your one thing isn't going to be my one thing. Proverbs 16, people may be pure in their own eyes, but the Lord examines the motives. Proverbs 21, verse 2, people may be right in their own eyes, but the Lord examines the heart. We can all get to a stage where we think we're right, and then God comes along and goes, let me just show you this. And I don't want to show it to show you up. I want to show you so it won't show you up. God is so loving, so gracious, so amazing. He doesn't want to force the issue. I've said that. He wants us to face the issue so that we can live a much better life than we've already lived. How many of you are into that? You know, into a better life than you've already. You might say, well, I've had a good life. Like you're sounding like you're off somewhere. I've had a good life. I had a guy once, I was selling a piano or something to him. And he came in and he said, I'm satisfied with life. I've got a great pension and I've got a great house and I drive a great car and I have a great wife. That was last on the list, by the way. Kind of something wrong with the priorities right there, but he died about a month later. Thought, well, what was the point of all that? Sometimes we get to a stage where we get stuck and satisfied. And I don't think we should ever get to a stage where we're not satisfied with God, but listen, there's more of God to be satisfied with. And he wants to do something right now in this moment. Would you stand with me to access something in your heart, to reveal something to you in order to release something more? I was thinking about how to end the experience, to end the service. Thinking about what he would want me to say, and I guess as he's not given me anything different to what I've got here, I'm going to tell you what he told me. And that was, what would it take? What one change is he touching on today that could transform your life forever? I want you to just think about that for a second. That's, sometimes we don't like silence, but silence is good. Silence is golden. Just think and let him have access. I wonder right now whether you're already going, don't touch that. God, don't go there. Please, please, please don't go there. Or are you open, like the psalmist had learned to be, and you're saying to God right now, do you know what? What's the point of me trying to say that to you when you can see everything anyway, because I can't hide anything. I've been running, but I can't hide anymore. God, you have access all areas. If you're prepared to say that to him today, if you're prepared to say to him, you have access all areas, I want you to raise your hand so I can pray with you. Awesome. That's great. I believe there's many joining us online with their hand physically in the air where they are and just saying, God, I want you to have access all areas. I don't want to be closed. I want to be open. I want to know what's holding me back. I want to know that one thing that I could change right now that would transform my life forever. Father, I pray over every person that's put their hand up, and it's not in the putting up of our hands that makes the difference, but it's in the opening of our hearts. But we acknowledge by our hands what's gone on in our hearts. And today, Father, we want to give you this pass. We want to say, God, have access all areas. I know you've only had ASA, but now I'm giving you AAA status. I want you, Lord, to access the deep parts of my heart. I want you to access the deep issues of my heart. I want you to access the things that I've failed to see because they've been so deep-rooted that, yes, once I saw them, but now I don't. It's almost become such a part of me that I actually excuse myself. Other people excuse me by saying, well, that's just the way he is, or that's just the way she is. That's just the way they are. That's just the way they work. And God, I don't want people to say that about me because that sounds so negative. I want people to say, no, you can say anything to them because they're open. Their life is an open book. And God, we want you to do that work on our hearts so that we can be that transparent and that open to other people. We want to be a church, Father, of people that are transparent through and through, that people can see us for who we are because that's what you see is what you get. Because we have nothing to hide. We want to be integrous people. Help us, Lord, today to deal with that one thing. Even as we're praying now, that one thing. As we leave the building today, that one thing. And if you don't know Jesus today, then the one thing you need to do to make your life all that it can be, to live the life that God has prepared for you, is to just do that one thing of saying, God, come into my life today in a personal way. I accept you. I give you access to my heart, and I know my life will never be the same again. Show me the things in me that have offended you. Show me the things that I've not got right, not that I can do anything about it, but I can accept that you have already done everything that needed to be done to put those things right that were wrong. And if anybody prayed that prayer, either in the building here or online. If you're in the building, I just ask you to raise your hand. If you haven't known Jesus and you've given your life to Jesus today, just raise your hand. But there will, I'm sure, be people online that will be doing that. If you're online right now, if you're on YouTube, make your way over to our website, destinyuk.com. Go on to the live page. Go on to watch this message, and you will see a button underneath, an option underneath, which says Next Step. When you press that option, it will take you to a little questionnaire, a little form. And we'd like you to fill that in and just send it back to us, all online, so that we can connect with you, so that we can pray for you, because we don't want this just to be a one-off thing. We want to have connection with you, and we want to help you. And wherever you are in the world, we will do everything we can to try and connect you with a church if you're not already connected. But you've made the best decision you've ever made to make Jesus the Lord of your life by doing that one thing today.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.